something, as long as I talk and give a little prasad and send you away, you won't think much about the truth of whatever I am speaking. If I ask you to meditate half an hour, then you will think, why should I? Who knows whatever he is speaking is right or not? You will start thinking. Half an hour meditation itself will make you think about the truth of my philosophy, whatever I am uttering. If I ask you to chisel half an hour a stone, then you will think 1000 times whatever I am speaking is right or wrong. You will think 1000 times, why should I chisel? Why should I work? Who knows this fellow is enlightened or not? Who knows what he is speaking is right or wrong? You will think 1000 times. When you start working, naturally you will try to verify the ideology which you are believing. That is why all revolutions on the planet Earth is done by workers. Whether it is communism or capitalism, anything, any ism, by workers. When you work, you will start reconsidering. You will start reviewing. You will start rethinking the philosophy which you believe, for which you work. Here, thousands of people sitting and working, not only working, creating the, expressing the creativity. This cannot happen unless they are really convinced. Unless they are really convinced. Unless you are convinced about the ideology which you are practicing, unless you are convinced about the ideology which you are learning, you will not go for working. Thousands of workers working on stone with no machineries, Pyramids are not granite, they are soft stones. All South Indian temples are granite, very strong. One of the hardest granites available on the planet Earth is South Indian granites. South Indian granites are hardest granites. Still, after 5000 years, the temples do not need any repairing. They are there standing. That is why they have not used any mortar in between the stones. You need to know important information. No mortar is used between stones in traditional Indian temples. No. The stones are carved so perfect. They are just made to sit on each other. Over. Maybe sometime there will be locking system inside. Over. That's all. No mortar is used. And no earthquake or lightning or natural calamities can shake them. Nothing. You will be surprised. There are so many cities I can say. Temples are much bigger than the whole city. Even now, we have temples which are occupying the 70% place of that city. Just only 30% of the city is city. 70% land is temple. The city is nothing but the people who are assisting are taking care of the temple. That's all. People live around temples. Cities are created around temples. The whole culture is created around temple. The village in which I am born and brought up, I can call that only as a village because it is not even a district headquarters. It was just unincorporated county. That's the right word. If I have to compare with the US standards. Unincorporated county. In that, we have a temple, 25 acre built up area, granite, completely. 8,000 granite pillars are there. 8,000 granite pillars are standing. 2 million stone carvings are there. 2 million stone carving. Each stone carving takes at least 6 months of one person who is skilled artist. Skilled artist has to spend at least 6 months on one stone to create one carving. It's not a small joke. It's not a small joke. And you can't think that 2-3 people working on one stone. No, it's not possible. Because too mild work. 2-3 people can't work. And moreover, any statue, only one person can clearly comprehend the head, hands and all the sizes, the proportion. If two, three people are working, the proportion will miss. There won't be proportion. Head will be one size and the leg will be other size. So naturally, one person has to assimilate, digest and do the job. Why I am telling about all these things? Understand, if so many creators, artists, intelligent people are produced by that system, means what will be the power of that basic faith? What will be the power of that basic ideology? What will be the power of that basic truth on which the whole tradition was built? Just want to say a few words about one temple which is there in my native place. The story, history says, it took at least 600 years for them to complete the temple. But the day one when they started, they had a complete master plan. You may ask, how do you know they had a master plan? Because the inauguration or the first ceremony is done always at the edge of the temple. At the entrance, main entrance gate of the temple is the place they will first start constructing. It means what? They know the complete boundary area. Only then they can start from the outermost entrance. Not like US, they will start from here and go out. No. First they will have the clear master plan. The Ishanya. Ishanya means the north east corner. The northeast corner is the place they will start the Bhumi Puja or the first ceremony, and they will have the whole outer structure ready first. 600 years. 600 year means at least some 20 generation. At least 20 generation of architects, the stone workers, has to work. Because when you work in the stone, you can't live more than 50 years. So much of dust going inside, your lifespan will be reduced. If you are directly working on stone, your lifespan will be less. And moreover, naturally, when you, by the time you start working, it will be 25 or 30. It's not that day one you start working. No. So, maximum if somebody lives 75 years, he will be working for only 50 years. At least 20 generation, the architects, as to architects would have worked. One important thing you should know, there is no method to store the drawing. No paper, no laptop, no computer, no drawing mechanism, no electronic media to transmit that concept. Now we have so many methods. We are now 3D way of thinking. Means clearly they project in a 3D way. You can do alteration. So many things can be done in the laptop, in the computer system. So many things can be done. Those days nothing was there. 20 generation of workers were able to digest, assimilate the main concept and carried on. That itself is unimaginable. Just try to convince your kids to do some puja or ritual or meditation for half an hour. You will understand how difficult it is. Convincing the next generation, how difficult it is. But these guys are able to convince at least 20 generation. 600 years they were able to convince about the ideology, about this great truth, about this great tradition, and the whole city has to work for it. Understand? Oh, those days people were innocent, they never asked questions, they just did. No, never think. We have produced greatest intellectuals who said no to everything. There are some books in Indian tradition. The book is called Kandana Mandana Vada, means the author is pulling down all kinds of traditions. All beliefs and all traditions must be a tabloid journalist. The guy must have been a tabloid journalist. He has not taken birth in modern days. He is criticizing everybody right and left. See, these tabloid journalists, they will criticize everybody. They will never allow their pictures to be published in anything, because people will start criticizing them. They will preserve their personal identity, their personality. That's why all over the world, people who write these tabloid things, they will have the nickname or some different face, different identity, just to protect them. This guy also does the same thing, criticizing everybody, but he himself is not proposing any theory. Disciple asks him, "You are criticizing everything, I understand. You are saying everything is wrong, I understand. Why don't you propose a theory?" He says, "No, I will never do that mistake, because next generation guy will criticize me. If I propose a theory, next generation fellow will criticize me." We had all this kind of a great intellectuals. We have given birth to the greatest atheist, Charvaka. 5,000 years ago, he is writing a beautiful theory. Actually, if you read the theory, the modern day atheists, like communists, all these guys are two pygmies. They don't have a strong logical intellectual support, idea to declare that there is no God. But these Charvakas have got a strong logical theory. Very strong arguments to prove there is no God. Even in atheistic theories, we have reached top levels. We have produced giant atheists. See, in the modern day atheists, they just spread atheism like one more religion, out of power. They don't spread atheism out of logic or convincing people. No, it's one more power over. Always tell people, atheism or theism, both are religions used by different people to achieve their ends. That's all. To achieve their ends. So, even in atheism, the Vedic tradition people have achieved different heights. They achieved different heights. And so logical, we had all these kind of people. But with all these kind of disturbances, with all these kind of atmosphere, with all these kind of people, our masters are able to create such huge infrastructures, temples, just because there is a truth behind the whole tradition. There is a strong truth behind the whole tradition. They were able to break stones just by sound. I myself have seen one yogi, he will just take a stone in the hand and create a sound through tongue, the hammer sound. Just as if the hammer is hitting the stone, just in tongue he will create the sound, the stone will be two piece and he will give it to you. Because sometime I used to wonder how these guys have broken or digged out so much of granite. How could they get so much stone out of the hill, and how could they work so much with the stones? They used all methods, all systems, all different techniques. These huge temples and the lifestyle which they lived is the testimonial or the standing example of the power of the tradition. Understand, only if you understand the background and the power of the tradition, you will be able to relate with the technique. Otherwise, you can't understand this technique. Just the technique says, enter the sound of your name, and through this sound, He will go beyond all sounds and achieve enlightenment. It will be very difficult. It will be very difficult. If you go back to your home and your family, your spouse or somebody asks, what did that Swami teach you? If you say, oh, he told me to repeat my name. They can't understand. What? For that you went to that Swami. I would have taught you much better things. That's what they'll tell. You went all the way to the temple to learn to repeat your name. No. Understand. Unless you understand the whole background, you will not be able to relate with the technique which I am teaching now. You should know why Shiva is saying, repeat your name. Because traditionally, name is given by an enlightened being according to the energy from which you took birth. If you are centered on intellect, head, then you are considered as a follower of Brahma. You will be more knowledge oriented. You will be more intellectual oriented. You will be given that kind of a name, Jnana. Jnana means intellect. You will be given that kind of a name. If you are more oriented towards heart, feeling, sensitivity, devotion, you will be more given a different kind of a name, belongs to Vishnu, Bhakti, tradition. If you are being oriented, meditation, technique, solid guys, being oriented people means very collective, strong, won't speak much but just do things. Strong people, tough guys, that's the right word. If you are that kind of a being, if you are that kind of a personality, seeing your engrams of your past birth, they will judge. If you are that kind of a personality, then you are Shiva energy. You belong to Shiva's energy, Shiva's tradition. They will choose name in that way. So, whenever you remember your name and the meaning with which, or the idea with which the name is given to you, that itself will remind you your path and the goal. Being reminded by your path and the goal is the best way to enlightenment. Vivekananda says, person who has got a clear goal and the path, if he does 5 mistakes, the person without the clear path and goal will do 5,000 mistakes. When you have a clear path and goal and constantly reminded about it, you will not waste your energy unnecessarily in different dimensions. Now, after becoming doctor and practicing 10 years, suddenly you will realize you are in the wrong place. Too late. I have seen many people, especially in this country, coming and talking to me. Swamiji, now I feel like I should change the profession. You can, but too late. And after living so many years, they say, I am with the wrong person. You can change, but too late. The years you lived, over. Years you lived, is over. Because after all, you are going to be on the planet Earth for some 70-80 years. Maximum 100 years. And the number of years you lived, wasted, over. So, understand, having the clear idea about the engrams which you brought and your path and the goal will reduce the time wastage, energy wastage and unnecessary things getting accumulated around you. You will not waste your time. In the Indian tradition, the naming, giving a name, was used as a technique to give you the path and the goal. It was like a compass for your life. Your name is the compass with which your name is a navigator, with which you will constantly be reminded about your goal and the path. What you are supposed to achieve, what you are supposed to be, fulfilling The meaning of your name is the fulfillment.